so much to this conference with an opportunity to network City again, to use the time that we have left, about 45 minutes, to ask these people questions. So, first, I saw the first hand up there. There you go.
Thank you very much. I have a short comment and a question. I have a short comment and a question to Sophie. The comment is that on Thursday, our Prime Minister said that she doesn't know if vaccines are helping people. On the radio. Right. And my question is about something else. Do you think that the profit motive is... do you think that people will ever stop lying if they can make profit of it? And if not, should we tackle it from a different point?
Yeah, you want to respond immediately? Okay. Thanks for letting me to that of the Polish Prime Minister. it's Polish, right?
Yeah.
But it's good that you mention it, because we're organizing a Standing Up for Science workshop for researchers in Poland, in Warsaw, in November. And it's good to be alerted that we might expect some discussion on that, and I'll add some extra materials on vaccination, things like that. But just to say as well, we're trying to activate the research community as well to respond to things like that. So if somebody with the role of authority makes a claim like that, which cannot be proven, you know, which is clearly not evidence-based, what we want is that there's a whole community waiting there to stand up against that. And so Susan is doing all the work, her part of the job. We think the research community should do their part of the job as well. And so for your question, one of the main themes of our work is accountability. We think everybody with a role of power, whether it's a company or a politician or anybody or an NGO, anybody with a role of power needs to be accountable for the claims that they make. And we think it's up to citizens to hold them to account. That's why we have campaigns like Ask Permanence, which are exactly for that. So I'm sure there will always be a temptation to just follow your own interests and to betray people and to misinform people when it will benefit yourself. And that's why we need things like transparency and people just keeping that critical attitude and asking for reference whenever claims like this are.
Does anyone else want to comment on that?
So, yeah. So I want to contrast that declaration with the new Prime Minister who said, if parents don't vaccinate, are they actually good parents? So, that was hopeful for the law for waiting on. But it's something to keep in mind. People don't necessarily think the same on this issue, and you can engage with the politicians and ask them to explain. Criticize significantly for this sort of declaration, strongly as an NGO, as you can contact other NGOs and say we need to provide a common platform presenting this specific.
Just a comment that according to their own belief systems, they are very good parents. I've had a lot of experience. ego, and it's about your definition of a skeptic, and also this in the context of how we want to educate the public and what tools we want to give them. So, in your, you mentioned an experiment you did in your creative thinking class, correct? With a voodoo doll? Oh, did I say created? Not created. Critical. If I understand correctly, some of the people did not wish to participate. The experiment was about putting their significant other's faces on a voodoo doll and doing stuff that's not pretty good. So, when I was thinking about this, your interpretation was that the meme that it carried enhanced their decision making, and thus we can conclude that they're not totally rational actors, right? Listening to this, I also thought about conventional kind of representation of like an extended identity locus. For example, when you show somebody a picture of someone and cut off their head, it kind of seems funny because you're not recognizing this person. We think about two new representations of someone that reports to us, and when you put somebody's face on a doll, when you hurt them, the superstition can be one part of it, but another part is the emotional response to kind of feeling like you're hurting somebody that's important to you. And that's kind of like cognitive inhibition, right? It's like executive function. Yes, I'm getting to the end right now. Cognitive inhibition is like you stop thinking about things that are not relevant to the task at hand and they do not influence your decision. So my question is, do we need, the way we want to educate the public, do we need them to be totally rational actors, or could we do it like a small step approach? For example, somebody is afraid of GMOs, but they are aware enough of their cognitive process that they will not buy they'll prefer something that says non-GMO, but they're still not advocate against GMOs online because they know like how important that action would be. Another question would be, I'm very sick, I like supplements, but I only have a dollar, so instead of spending that on a bottle of vitamin C, I'll just buy 2 bottles of mineral water to hydrate myself. Do we need people to be like ideal rational actors, or is it enough to kind of show them how they can influence their decision making in important matters while still keeping their anxieties for a while? Sorry for being so long.
My question is for Adam.
You asked me two questions in one, because you asked about GMO and then about the rationality, right? Something like this.
No. I have a question. Like, do we need people to be rational actors when we kind of educate the public, or is it not kind of give more awareness?
To give them more
awareness of their decision process.
So but
like, if they don't make superstition-based decisions, then what do you want to achieve?
I don't think we can be 100% rational, because that would be delusional to say something like this. I think the problem is about educating ourselves and educating people. For instance, what we were talking about, the belief that activates a superstitious thinking. If a person knows nothing about voodoo dolls, never seen a movie or like read a book about that, probably that person won't have any problem to perform that exercise because there is no knowledge about it. And same goes with the example of the banana. If you walk in a field and find a banana, you'll probably maybe try to find out if that is a GMO or a natural banana, and then eventually try to eat it or not. You know, you won't activate something that is connected with your culture, what I call the mini place where you come from, right? So it depends what we mean by being rational. I think that, as I said in my speech, rationality comes with a proper analysis of the premises behind the conclusion we came to, or the ideology we had. And about like genetically modified food, the problem is that people take position. So it's like a yes or no. And it seems to me they don't quite bother to analyze the evidence about it. And there is not even like much an effort from the media to provide the evidence. And then there is also a conspiracy thinking because people say, I don't care about the evidence because the evidence are produced by and sort of stuff. So I think that when we talk about the rational thinking, we have to be careful about what we mean, because there are many atheists. For instance, I'm a board member of the International Atheist Organization. Many atheists claim to be rational thinkers. They are not rational thinkers at all. At all, actually. Or there are religious people who claim to be absolutely rational. There are spiritual preachers who claim to be absolutely rational because they are involved in that field. So I think we have to be very careful with this definition of rationality. And we cannot really teach people how to be rational. We can teach people how to properly analyze evidence, facts, and again, the premise, the sound accuracy of the premise is behind the conclusion they can find, they can read online, or they themselves make. Am I clear now?
Can I ask an additional question to that? But can we teach people to be aware of their own confirmation bias, for instance? Wouldn't that be very useful? To be aware that there is, most people are not aware that there is something as a confirmation bias.
There's a big question, because when people are deeply involved in confirmation bias and you try to teach them about how to deal with it, they will probably engage in another confirmation bias by creating another counter justification about it. I think the best way to teach probably teaching is not enough. They have to understand how it works. I think we probably can make people understand how confirmation bias works by using metaphors, by talking about it not directly, but using like a third person, like what if. You come across a person that says this and that. I mean, I'm talking about the person, but I'm using a third character. And then probably we think about it, but it's very tricky and it's very difficult actually, because usually confirmation bias is very ingrained in people's psychology, and it's pretty much everywhere. We can find there is a motto in. The current New Age movement, which if I'm not wrong, they say science is about discovering and spirituality is about knowing. And knowing what is actually, knowing whatever you like to know. So that some people believe that spirituality is about believing the planet is flat, other people believe in angels, other people believe that that's not true, and that the spirituality is energy, I don't know, healing or whatever. So, it's very difficult. The problem is that critical thinking is underestimated greatly, and there are also many studies that unfortunately show how critical thinking does not quite work, because to my mind it's a little bit too much methodological, and then in the real life it's not applied. And I believe that critical thinking must be unified with memetics, and multilogical thinking, metacognition. And I guess that it would be nice to see this translated into algorithms for the future of artificial intelligence to come. Otherwise, as I said, I think we would have a serious problem.
I would suggest
we
stay on track.
But
I'm sorry, Andres, but I want to say one last thing about that. After reading Thinking Fast and Slow, you know that, I don't trust my own judgment anymore. And that's a really good thing. And I think everybody, every citizen should, you know, read that book or get the basic principles of how our mind works from that school so that people don't trust their own judgments, because that's what it's about.
Can you see the last one?
Which book did you
say? I just want to add something. I don't know.
comfortable saying, I don't know. So that
I know a person now that is really comfortable.
My question is, are we already taking measures to take advantage I hope to be voting very soon. Thank you.
One of the problems with EU policy is that although they attempt to be transparent on the decisions and how the decisions are taken, it's a bit fake transparency. So you can find a lot of stuff online, but you also already have to know where to look for it. And it's all very, if you have one specific question, I often don't find the response myself, and I have 10 years of experience with EU policy, and it's just all way too complicated and too much. So one of the things that Center for Science is doing there is increasing the transparency, and we have a whole framework on the transparency of the evidence that's used in government policies, which we've been applying to UK policy. If you want people to interact with what the government is doing, you need people to know what they are doing. We're not at the second step yet, where we would mobilize people to do all that. Although our Evidence Matters project, working with the Parliament, is a step in that direction. Because you do have people in Brussels who are representing you. They're not always doing a brilliant job in representing you, but they are there. They are representing the European Parliament. They've been voted by, you know, by the people. And that's something that we're trying to do as well, is to reconnect.
Sorry, could you move your mic away from your mouth?
That's not why it's being picked So we're trying to reconnect the citizens also with their representatives there, so that they have a louder voice, and so that as a citizen you can come in with a single issue and you can expect your representative to defend your interests there. So it's complex. There's no easy and immediate answer to that first question. Also, I'm trying to map a bit what's going on at national level, but I've only just started doing that. So that's a bit my non-answer to your first question, sorry. I have to say, I didn't entirely understand your second question.
In terms of across the EU action for vaccination, there's two things I'm aware of. There are medical conferences where, at one point, the thought of a European-wide vaccination schedule was raised. Epidemiologically, it makes sense because we're living in very similar places and similar rates of disease across various issues. But there's nothing that the European Union does not go into country legislation regarding vaccination policy. And that is what we've been trying to get addressed. However, what is happening now, and there is a trend that we need to get on, is countries are starting to move towards more restrictive vaccination legislation. So I've kind of made the point to pass probably Germany started doing was a bit more strict recently. So that trend will probably continue. And if it continues, we can support it with our help for the regulator to have supporting the population, you would say, but it would be us coming in and communicating to the public, saying, okay, this is why we need more careful vaccine schedules. This is what we allow people who are not vaccinated to schools. This is what we're doing. You can explain vaccination all day and never finish. So, there is that need in the population to learn it, and that's where we can, regardless of doing it at EU level and a regulator level or at country level, the impact will be there. In terms of regulatory impact, I think it will be still some time until we can discuss an EU-wide vaccination scheme. It's probably, you know, going to take time. Each country will need to face its own anti-vaccine movement locally, and then take the decision based on that.
So one of the things that I want to make sure I point out really, really quickly is that everybody here can edit Wikipedia. You do not need to have an account. And the first thing I think that needs to be done is you need to look at your Wikipedia pages for all these topics you're talking about and what kind of order they're in. You can fix them in all languages. That's the first thing, because that's where people are going to get their information. So policies, yes, and all that, but that's where they're going. You don't want to find another cutting page that says it works. You need to look at that first. Go there first, fix that first, don't wait for GSOW, get it done, and then all the great advice you're hearing. But the first thing you do is go to Wikipedia.
My question is, will you try to call the pronunciation wrong?
Okay.
So, do you think that the anti-vaccine activists, they know that they have a false narrative, or do they actually believe in that narrative? And if they, like, if they're deliberately spreading lies, then what is their motivation behind this?
Okay, so there's two types. The most common one are honest parents who are afraid and have been scared into anti-vaccination. They are honest in what they spread out. They are honestly uninformed. And they are honestly wrong. So those are, you know, they're hard to engage with on a one-to-one level, because you have to understand they are parents, they want the best for their kids, and that is not a false statement. That is the truth of any normal parent. However, it's not them that are the problem. This is being created by leaders in the movement, and the leaders are usually interested in something. For Romania, the most common, I guess it's going to be common, one of the leaders is the formal leaders, it's not, none of them are very strongly leaders, they don't, you know, they look garden t-shirts like that. But they do come out as leaders, and one of them was a former TV presenter who just got popular because presenters have their own pages, and then she started talking about cooking, and from that moved into natural health, and then from that to vaccines, and then because she's the wife of a still active TV presenter, she's popular in the tabloids, so anything she says gets translated, moved into tabloid, and then that gets into the popular information. Others are activists for healthy birth, so we get a natural birth advocates, which is not good, but then they combine that with, okay, you gave a natural birth, which is very good, nice, good for you, and now don't vaccinate your kid, because that's not natural. So they make that transition very easy for the parents who are inclined to a natural way of thinking, and are, of course, how would you say, you know, how would you argue with someone saying you shouldn't treat your child with natural things, good things, with naturalistic fallacy we're aware of, right? So they get that, and they go with parents to the next step. The next step is anti-vaccine, the next step is anti-doctors, the next step is anti-fever management, that happens. And the next, after all that, then you go into anti-cancer, and then you are afraid of chemtrails. It's true. And then there's lawyers, and we have that. Lawyers jump into this mostly because they see the potential for trials, which might get compensation for the parent, and of course there's something for the lawyers into. So there are some people who are interested, and others who are honest in this. I've tried talking to both. The ones who are interested are very dismissive and usually block any conversation. The ones who are honest, depends how much patience you have, basically. Because it can get very heated very rapidly. It can go many ways. But yeah, that's the main topic, and it's hard to say what definition line is. Some of them are definitely interested. I know if I can give an example. One of the natural birth advocates had on her website the information that Edward Jenner, the creator of the first vaccine, the smallpox vaccine, this is important why I'm saying it, was created the German measles vaccine. So it's not exactly true. And then this child died because of the smallpox vaccine that his parent did. So Edward Jenner had a child who died from tuberculosis 20 years after the smallpox vaccine. And also have a friend who actually went to anti-vaccine pages, took a post that an anti-vaccine page did, and he was, I think he's a scientist, he said, listen, you're making a mistake in this article, I think you want to fix it. This is how you should read the study, this is how the data should be interpreted, this is why you should interpret it this way. Basically making a full correction of the information in the article. Two results. Nothing. Deleted comment. Blocked user was the third one. So, you could say it varies. The reaction and the willingness to be right and to be based in science is very, very.
I'd just like to add something to this, that it's a very interesting academic question, what you've just asked. I think from an activism perspective, it doesn't matter. The leaders of the anti-vaccine movement are definitely the ones we should go after and not worried parents. However, whether these anti-vaccine activists are honest in their belief or they have something in it, I don't think it matters. We need to go after their message, we need to sometimes even go after them, regardless of whether they're honest or not.
On a slightly lighter note, if I may, Susan, thank you very much for mentioning journalists. As a science correspondent for public radio in this country, I would very much like to rant about us being overworked and underfunded, thank you very much. And I'm sure you'd like to hear my rant, but instead I've got two pieces of good news and a general question or a request for the panel. First piece of good news that our Polish Prime Minister, notwithstanding, the health minister last year vaccinated himself against influenza on cameras in this country. The second piece of good news is that within a walking distance from this building, there's another building that in 1963 in this city was the center of coordination for fighting smallpox. There was an outbreak and this city was sealed. The reason I'm saying it's good news is that the older generation of doctors who are still practicing in their academics and they teach, they remember. So I think, don't quote me on this because I haven't got the numbers off the top of my head, but this country is very much, very well vaccinated, and I think in many cases we've got herd immunity still. My request is this. I've been an educator all my life, be it educating people on the radio, universities,